Dude, do you love a church that takes risks? Isn't that awesome? Dude, what a blast. That's my jam right now. Okay, that's what the young people say, but, you know, I'm with them all the time. This is what I do, so I can use that word. When I think about Coldplay, who wrote that song with Chainsmokers, I think about Psalm 20. I'm not necessarily going to take the rest of my text from Psalm 20, but I want you to hear these words, because I look at a generation in America today who is looking for love. Something like this, right? It's not the superhuman effort, you know, and skills. It's not Spider-Man's, you know. It's not Superman's or Batman's. No, see, I believe that this generation is looking for reality. They're looking for something genuine, something real. And if they can't find it in church, where are they going to find it? Right? I mean, think about that. The church should not be trying to be like culture, because culture is not fulfilling them. And that's that struggle that we have, isn't it? Like, you know, how much do we risk if we're going to go out and reach people? How important is reaching them with the gospel, right? And Paul said, by any means, we'll do whatever it takes, even hot 100s, right? I mean, we're going to do a series on God at the movies this fall or whatever, right? I spoke at Popcorn Church. That's what they call it, Popcorn Church. It's a brand new church. It meets in the theater. And their idea is, we're going to reach anyone however we can, right? And so when I think of what people are listening to all week, and what is invading their space all week, if the church isn't willing to go there, do we really have a chance at getting them, right? But it doesn't necessarily mean that we drop our standards or we water down the word, right? I mean, think about that. When I hear these words that Chris Martin wrote, when I hear those words, I want something that I'll miss, right? I think of my friends. I did not grow up in the church. But I think of my friends who, if they could see me now, I've said that so many times, if my friends could see me now, they'd be like scratching their heads. They'd be like, really? That's not the guy we knew, right? But there's something so real that I found, I want them to see it, right? And I believe that's how God is working in this series. Ever since Pastor told me what was going on, I've been praying for you. Even though I don't know you, right? I've been praying for you that God would take this series and use it in a way to, listen, we got to stop coming to church and start being the church. Some of us are more excited about coming to church, right? And then we lay it down and we're like, well, okay, Jesus, you stay here. You know, I'll be back, but you stay, right? I'll see you next week, Lord. No, we got to stop worrying about coming to church and be more vigilant about being the church, you know? And Psalm 20, man, I was looking at this. I pulled the words out, and I put them of Chris Martin's song, something just like this. And I put them beside this, and this is what Psalm 20 says. May the Lord answer you in your day of trouble. May the name of God defend you. May he send you help from the sanctuary. Not from superheroes, right? May he send you help from the sanctuary, and may he strengthen you out of the people of Zion. That's the church, right? Listen, may he remember all your offerings, your worship, and accept your sacrifices. May he grant you according to your heart's desire and fulfill all your purpose. I mean, think about that. I want something real. This is the desire of the heart of this world, is for something real. And I think the song misses it, because it's not something just that we miss and it's a kiss and, right, it's a person, but it's our creator. Amen? It's our creator. And I think that is the cry of this heart, of his heart, when Chris Martin was writing this song. And when I hear it played, I pray for it all the time. I travel a lot. I'm only home about a day or two a week. And so I'll be in a rental car, and I'll get satellite radio. And, you know, I'll play certain songs that are in that area or that city or whatever, right? And I'll hear that, come on, and I'll start praying. This song has caught my heart because I start praying for the desires, as David said in Psalm 20, for the desires of man's heart in that area. And God, would you please turn their heart not to a kiss, not to an earthly relationship, but to you. Amen? And it's just my efforts, you know. I'm going to leave this area, and you're still going to be here. That's kind of the easy part about doing what I do, right? Come blow in, blow up, blow out, you know, whatever, and leave the mess with you. And it's your responsibility, right, to show them something just like this. And so that's where I want to go with our text this morning from 1 Corinthians 13. We call it the love chapter, right? So I want you to go there, 1 Corinthians 13, and you're going to see this theme that Paul was writing on that I think mimics what David was writing on in Psalm 20. What is it really that people want? What is really the desire of man's heart? Is it gifts? Is it icons? Is it money? Right? What is it really that people want? Because you all know people who've had the gifts who are not fulfilled. That gifted person that's not fulfilled. You know people who've had the money and they're not fulfilled. And most of us in this room think, well, man, if I had his or her, if I had that gift, if I had their look, right? Or if I had their money, man, I know I would be spiritual. Well, how's it working for most of them, right? See, sometimes we get our desires from the wrong place and not from our Creator, right? In 1 Corinthians 13, you know the story. Paul is writing to the church in Corinth, okay? It's interesting that the Bible always comes, its words always come from a place. Always comes from a place of application. So if you're here, and I know many of you may be, you know, charter members of this place, and you've been here for a long time, but maybe you walked in this morning and you've never been to church before, right? Or it's just a few weeks and you're still trying this faith out. I want you to know, when I read these words, Paul wrote these words to a city. He wrote them to the city of Corinth, who was struggling with love, okay? And this is what it says in verse 1 of 1 Corinthians 13. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but I do not have love, I become like a sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains, but I do not have love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to even feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. So think of just those first three verses. It's like Paul is saying, you can have all your superhuman gifts. You can have Batman's fists, right? You can have everything. But if you don't have love, not a kiss, because a kiss is different than love. Hello. Right. Yeah, listen. I don't mind if you talk back at me, okay? I'm used to like talking to teenagers, and they're talking the whole time anyway, you know. Sometimes it's not about the service, but, you know, so just like bring it. You won't scare me. It won't make it any longer either, okay? It'll just make it more interesting. So, yeah. When I think of those first three verses, I'm thinking Paul's covering it all. He's covering the gifts. He's covering prophetic words. He's covering all the spiritual things, right, that we think set us apart from this world. And yet he's trying to get us to see we can have all of that, but we still lack if we don't have love, right? And then he begins to define love. So he gives us the importance of love here. Now, look what he says. Love suffers. It suffers long and it's kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. It is not puffed up, does not behave rudely, does not seek its own, is not provoked, it doesn't think of evil. Love Listen, love doesn't think of evil. And we tend to move there quickly, don't we? We tend to move there judgmentally and critically. It does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Pastor Nate talked about that just a few minutes ago, right? Difficulty, hardship, and pain. Love endures all things. See, I'm walking through a very difficult time right now in my life. I have three children. They're all out of the house. Two are youth pastors, one in L.A., one in Minneapolis. And then my youngest son just is finishing up his last year at Hillsong in Sydney, a leadership college there, all moving toward youth ministry. And 19 months ago, my wife passed away. A long battle with cancer. But we truly believe that she had fulfilled her dash. She said to me just the night before she went into a coma, she said, "He's finished with me." I said, "No, no, baby, no, no, uh-uh, no, he's not done. We got this. We're just going to keep fighting." And they'd given her 2 to 3 months to live, and she lived for almost 2 years, just battling and fighting and continuing to preach and travel with me, even when she barely could, even from a wheelchair, taking students in, counseling students to continue to mentor students. And in the last evening of her life, she said, "He's done with me. I fulfilled everything he's called me to do." And to say goodbye to my best friend of 34 years was the most difficult moment of my life. But I'm telling you, the last 19 months, I felt nothing but love for my friends. This morning, early this morning, one of my friends for life, we've been friends for most of our life. He's a pastor of a mega large church. Took the time this morning to say, "Hey, I don't know where you are this morning. I want you to know I'm praying for you as I woke up." So I texted him back. I said, "I'm in Dover. I'm about ready to preach. I'm praying for you too." And he texted me back, "All right, okay. Well, we're both praying from the pulpit, from the same place, you know, for the same person and the same cause." It's those kind of people and things that have happened in my life that have carried me through the most difficult moment in my life. There's so much power and love to bring you through anything, anything. Oh, we're all just looking for love. That's what we're looking for. Acceptance, right? I've said for years, you can love someone and make them do anything. Really, that's pastoring. "Oh, we really need a volunteer. You're awesome." "I am? What time you need me?" I mean, right? You know, no, I don't think that's how he operates. He doesn't operate that way. But you know what I'm saying. It's just love. Love is so powerful. Okay, sorry. I got to keep reading here because there's a clock there that says I'm done shortly. Okay. You did not tell me what time to be done, so that was kind of nice. You don't remember. Okay, yeah. About the time the rest of the people are walking in, we should be out of here. I know that. That's for sure. By the way, okay, I'm sorry. I have ADHD. Okay, did you know there's a crowd over here too? Okay, yeah. I don't know what they're doing, but once in a while I hear this. I'm like, where am I, a club? Oh, hold it. They're over. I didn't even know. You just, they're over here too. Oh, this is creepy. Okay. So anyway, I knew they were there. This freaked me out right there for a moment though. I think he just woke up or something because I didn't hear him before. But so, like, I have ADHD, okay? Like, and this is not a joke. You know how you hear people say things like, you know, "Oh, sorry, it's my ADD kicking in." No, I have ADH, that's the hyper part, D. Because there's like 12 thoughts in my head right now, and I have to, like, get the one thought out that I'm on, and I'm totally off that right now, right? So, but I don't take my medication on days that I speak. That's a good thing. That's a really good thing. For you, it's a good thing for you. Because otherwise it would be like, "Hello. Let's talk about love." "Though I speak with the tongues." No, I'm sorry. So anyway, see, yeah. Back to the book. Love does not behave rudely. I read that already. Okay, love never fails. But whether there are prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part now, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part will be done away. And what Paul was saying is this. All of these other things are partial. All of this other stuff is part. Superman's strength, right? Batman's fists. Spider-Man's, whatever that was, control. All of it, it's partial. But the most important thing is love. And as he's defining this, we get an understanding of the kind of people that we should be. And then he says this, when I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I continued to be like a child. Right? No, sorry, I missed that there. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know partially, right? Prophecy is partial. I mean, all that stuff. Mysteries are partial. Knowledge is partial. Even your faith is partial to move mountains. All of this, if I give all my goods to the poor, that's all partial. That does not define Christianity. Those things, as honorable as they are, do not define Christianity. Christianity, he says, is not defined by the partial. It is defined by the whole. And now abide faith, hope, love, these three. But the greatest is what? Love. And so what he's saying, what Paul's saying is to the Corinthians, you guys think you have everything together because you're a port city, you're very wealthy, very materialistic, and your wisdom excels every other region in the Mediterranean. But that's not what it's about. It's about how much you love. Think this through. Where you want to go? How much you want to risk? I'm not looking for somebody with some superhuman gifts, some superhero, some fairy tale bliss, just somebody I can turn to, somebody I can miss. See, I believe that Chris Martin was talking about true love. True love. He's just not defining it like we would in the scriptures. And I think Paul was defining to us true Christianity. It's not words or deeds. Right? It's not words or all these other things that he listed there. It's love. So I want to be as real. Can I like be real to you? I finished writing this message early this morning. I want to give you 10 ways to love people. I've never done this on a Sunday. I've never done like top 10 on a Sunday morning, right? Never did that before. I don't even know if I ever did it in my youth ministry. I want to give you 10 ways that you can spread God's love in Dover, in this region. So, you know, would you write maybe one on each finger or, you know, something like that? Or I'm sure you get the broadcast here and we can put that out and you can listen to it again and get the notes. But 10 signs that we are a loving church or I'm a loving person to the people of Dover. Number one, love changes our attitude. And I'm going to do these all in about 1 minute each, okay? So you got to listen fast. Love changes our attitude about everything, about every situation, about every person. Hear me. You are not a victim or a snowflake. You know what I'm talking about? I know they tell everybody, the media tells everybody that this generation is the snowflake generation, that they're soft and they're changing, you know, and they're brittle and whatever. But I don't believe that. I really don't. I don't believe that. I mean, they act that way, but I think deep down inside, our attitude is stronger than that. As a church, I believe love changes our attitude toward everything. Number two, love is greater than hate. Love is greater than hate. I want to ask you a difficult question. When is the last time you cried for an unchurched person? When is the last time you cried for a teenager? When is the last time you cried for the family next to you that's falling apart? When is the last time you cried for that coworker who's going through divorce? Number three, love reminds us of our beginning. Do you remember your beginning in Christ? I remember how I was living. Man, I was lit, as they say, but in the wrong way, if you know what I'm talking about. The Bible says that Paul was stoned. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Some of you know exactly where I'm going with that. When I look at my life before Christ and after Christ, I think back to my beginning. Listen, love reminds me of the beginning of my relationship with God when he forgave me of everything. Everything that I had ever done, old things had passed away, and now new things came into my life. It was so powerful. To me, love reminds me of my beginning. Listen, do not grow, don't grow old in your faith and lose your love. That's a good word, sir. And that's the dude who planted this church or was here pastoring it for a long time ago. Let me tell you something. Oftentimes we grow up in our faith and we become ugly, man, like we were baptized in lemon juice, right? Or we attend the church of the frigid air, you know, or whatever. Listen, God has called us to grow in our love, right? Number four, love dances in the rain instead of staying inside. Think about this. I had a choice when my wife passed to bury myself. I had a choice to separate and isolate myself. I had a choice to blame God. I had a choice to blame others. I had a choice to say, you know, how come? Why? Understand, there are more how long, O Lord, in the scriptures than there are why, O Lord. Stop asking why and ask the Lord, how long? How long you want me to go through? I'll show. Difficulty, hardship, crisis? I'll show you how faithful I am, God. I never raised my proverbial fist at God and blamed him for what I was going through. Because I learned that even rain, fire, storms, chaos, crisis, discipline in my life is there for a reason. It's there for a reason. And yet in America, we feel so elite that we shouldn't be going through this. Not in the U.S. It shouldn't touch us. Hardship? Why? Not in the U.S. Not in my palace. Right? I remember God speaking to me saying, one thing I'm promising you is my presence. Dude, give me his presence over anything else. Take me through hardship. Take me through hardship, but give me his presence. I'll go through anything. I'll go through anything with his presence. Learn to dance in the rain. Don't curse it, because it's bringing your crop. Dancing in the rain brings your crop. Number five, love gives more than it receives. It gives more offering, it gives more time, it gives more resource, it gives more mercy, it gives more forgiveness, it gives more encouragement, it gives more grace, it smiles more. Love gives. Love doesn't take. For God so loved the world that he took. Mm-mm. For God so loved the world that he gave. Right? Listen, most of us are coming to church for free. And if you do that in the world, you get arrested. Most of us in the church are coming for free. And if you do that in the world, you get arrested. You don't take stuff for free. You don't take it off the counter. You don't get gas for free. You don't go to the club for free. the gym for free. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, I caught somebody's attention, and one of these guys were like, "Amen over there." I don't know. I'm joking. It was this side. No, it wasn't that side. Listen. I'm telling you, we shouldn't be doing this for free. Right? I mean, he asked for 10% and we tip him. And Pastor did not ask me to say this, but I push this almost everywhere I go. If the church would learn to tithe and learn to give, do you know how much money you would have? Do you know how much, you know, people, look at me, because I can leave and you don't have to get mad at him, okay? Do you know how much money the church would have if you would tithe? Just off the principle, just the principle of tithing. Not, I don't care if you make $20,000 a year. Can you imagine what would happen out of the obedience of the tithe? Not a $10 tip and think, wow, God, you got a 10 this week. I might give a 10 next week too. Really? That's how we're going to treat God. Trust his principle, because love gives. Love gives. Trust his principle, and you have so much money, you wouldn't know what to do. You wouldn't know what to do with it. You have to give more to the missionaries. All right. Sorry. I love you. Okay. Six. Love says something to the cashier at Panera. I said love gives, not love says. Now, love says, I'll never forget it, walk into Panera, order, right? Pick two, order. Her name is Alexis, says it right there on her badge. She takes the card all the way up her arms, our cuts. And I just simply said as she cashed me out, Holy Spirit, what do you want me to say? Did you catch that? I didn't say, Holy Spirit, do you want me to say something? He already told me to say something. Hello? He already told us to say something. What we say is up to us. And so I just said, Holy Spirit, what do you want me to say to Alexis? And she gave me the card back, and I simply looked at her arm. I said, Alexis, I see you used to cut. Because they're all healed. I was trying to be positive, right? And she was like, oh, mister, yeah, I used to, but I found God. I found God a few months ago, and she starts ministering to me. She starts speaking to me. I'm like, this is too easy, right? And she starts telling me her story, and I'm like, wow, no way. Hey, I'm an evangelist. I travel all over America, and I work with young at-risk young people. I have this organization, and I have this human trafficking organization that I work with. And she's like, no way. We hit it off in like a minute. See, if you'll just give God an opportunity to speak through you, he loves people more than you do. He wants to minister to your friends and your coworkers and your neighbors more than you do. I couldn't get away from it growing up. My wife kept a list of everyone in our neighborhood, their names, their numbers, their children, where they worked, in our cupboard. She knew I'd see it there. It's in the pantry where the chips are. And the little Debbies. Keep it right there, because she knew I was going to see it. And our kids saw it every time they went there. And we have to pray for our neighbors. Jesus. Seven. Love goes 2 miles, gives both our coat and our shirt, turns the other cheek, right? See, the Sermon on the Mount, I call it the New Testament commandments. The Sermon on the Mount is still for today. You want to define love? Just read the Sermon on the Mount. With the salt, with the light. You're supposed to go one, go two. They ask for your coat, give them the shirt. Someone takes advantage of you, turn the cheek. Eight, love serves on a Saturday that you might have off. It serves the pastor to help him move. Fills the fridge of the youth pastor. Isn't that what you wanted me to say, Andrew? Fills the fridge, bring groceries over. Did I get that right? Okay, yeah. Picks up the guest speaker at the airport. Barry, where's Barry? He's in kids. Drives, right, goes out of his way to get me, drive an hour or whatever, right? It goes out of its way. Listen, love serves. It babysits for free. See, love goes out of its way to serve others. Number nine, love looks into the mirror each morning and offers forgiveness to yourself. Some of you are beating yourself up. You're beating yourself up over things God is not even thinking about. Some of you are beating yourself up over things God has totally forgotten. He's moved on. When are you going to? As far as the east is from the west, he has forgiven you your sins, thrown it into the sea of forgetfulness. And that sea has a sign posted very clearly: do not fish. Love forgives yourself so that you can love others properly. If you don't love yourself, how are you going to love your neighbor? Right? Just look in the mirror tomorrow morning and say, God, I'm doing the best I can with what you gave me. I love you. I love you. You know what I'm saying? Forgive yourself. Finally, number 10, love never gives up on anyone. Love never gives up on anyone. It compels us to stay in this life, to stay in this life, and to love the misfit. God has called us to love the misfit. God has called us to love the stranger and the alien. Think it through. And now abides faith, hope, and love. Verse 13. Faith, hope, and love. These three things. But the greatest of these is you are measured not even by your faith. You are not measured by your hope, your future. You are measured by your love. Greatest characteristic of Christianity. The defining trait of Christianity is love. I want you to stand across this place, will you, please? God, speak to us in this quick response. Speak to us in this moment. God, show us something just like this. God, show us something just like 1 Corinthians 13. I don't want to just be a sound, a noise. I want to have purpose. I haven't found my purpose. I mean, I thought my purpose was work. I thought my purpose was my children. I thought my purpose was the golf league. Or God, I haven't found my purpose yet. And if you're telling me my purpose is love, man, that seems so easy. Listen, this morning, if you've never committed your life to Christ, there's going to be prayer team members here in just a moment. This team is going to lead us in a song, and there's prayer team members that are going to come and stand around. You know, maybe if the prayer team would, you know, maybe have a few in the back too. We can put, you know, some of you up here, some of you in the back, in case some people don't feel comfortable coming forward. Go in the back and pray with someone. I believe if you mean it, it won't matter to you if you really mean it, right? But this morning, maybe you've never accepted Christ as your Savior. I want to pray for you. It's really simple. Most of the people in this room have prayed this prayer before, and it's really simple. I want to pray for you if you've never given your life to Christ. Here's how it goes. If you bow your head, just repeat this prayer after me. Everyone in this room is going to say it. Everyone's going to say it, but specifically it's for you. Maybe you've attended this church for a long time, but you've never committed your life to Christ. Love certainly isn't the sign that you're showing. If that's you, say this simple prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, come on, say it out loud. Dear Lord Jesus, I trust you with my life. I am yours, you are mine. Take the old things away. Bring new things into my life. A new heart, a new mind. I believe in my heart that you are Lord. I confess with my mouth that you are risen from the dead. Forgive me of my sins. I am yours and you are mine. Forever. Forever. Will you thank him right now just for a moment? Just take like 30 seconds and just, if you prayed that prayer and something has come over you, that's his presence, right? That's forgiveness. That's new life. That's restoration. That's why we call this church restoration. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. I believe this. It's exactly what I needed today. Right? Listen, there's leaders in the back. There's a few up front. If that's you and you prayed that prayer, I want you to go to one of those leaders. They have a gift for you. They want to pray with you. Or maybe you need something else. Maybe you want healing in your body. Maybe you just want to bring your family up and you want to have someone pray for your family. Right? Let's not think that just every person that comes forward here is in trouble, right? That's what I used to think when I grew up. If you went to the altar, people were looking at you going, you're in trouble. Oh, you did it again. No, this is a place of sacrifice, a place to just pray, right? Right? So will you move? They're going to sing. Pastor's going to come in just a moment. But while they're singing, will you let someone minister to you? Will you? Come on. If you need prayer, I want you to step out right now. Go ahead, sing it.